Hello and welcome everyone. My name is Meepolis and this is Literally Graphic. Today we are going to be highlighting yet another work from one of my favorite mangaka, namely Taiyo Matsumoto. Much like the rest of his work that I've consumed thus far, GoGo Monster continues to deal with the lives of boys as they grow up. But not in any sort of macho or overly sentimental way, Matsumoto always seems to be able to place himself into the very serious world of childhood without rendering it too tragic or too trite. Originally published in 2000 by Shogakukan, it was interesting to look at the overall timeline of Matsumoto's work from Blue Spring and Tekkon Creech written 7 years before and Sunny written 10 to 15 years in the future. There's still quite a bit that has yet to be translated for me to read, and possibly maybe one or two more that have been translated that I've yet to read, but I have now completed everything that my library has, although I think he'll definitely be making his way onto, like, my to-be-bought list at some point, I think. Because I just, love me some Matsumoto. And looking at this trajectory overall, as well as supplementing it with a few biographies here and there, short as they are, it does seem to point to a sporty guy who has worked hard to develop a sense of compassion for himself and other men, someone emotionally intelligent beyond what I expect of the average, and not someone afraid to go into some weird corners. Like the rest of Matsumoto's comics, the art of GoGo Monster is much more ragged and expressive than most other manga I read. Reading through some more write-ups on the life and influences of Matsumoto, it wasn't too surprising to see a visit to France and a liking for European comics, often referred to as being a strong pull in his development as an artist. The only other manga in my experience, limited as it is, that really comes all that close to Matsumoto's style is the anthology of indie manga called Axe, which was made up of a collection of mangaka who obviously don't kowtow to market demands. There are a couple of writing issues I recall taking with that collection, but I also feel like Matsumoto shows his skill in comparison by maintaining such creative style without becoming hard to read. Not a quality universally important, but as a pretty hardcore pragmatist, something I always keep in mind. Digging into the story and writing elements of this book, however, I did need to step out on faith a bit and wait to be caught, as it were. Not that this is a bad thing, but I could see why some people not already sold on Matsumoto's style might be unwilling to go out on such a limb, even for such a short one-shot book. The decision to break down the book into the seasons, while not terribly original, does signal very hard to the fact that time is going to play a very important role in the story. And while it did feel sometimes like the story may not be getting very much of anywhere, being so cognitive of the time definitely kept me turning pages with bated breath. Perhaps due to this focus on the passage of time or the existence of an overarching plot, but I would not describe this book as a slice of life, which I guess isn't totally unheard of since black and white wasn't totally slice of life either, but still struck me as a bit unusual in my limited experiences with him. There is still a lot of world building that goes on, however, as well as some interesting uses of repetition that really built up the quote-unquote feeling of the book for me. Writing this review, I was actually surprised to be struck by how circular the story is overall, because while the plot has a very definite beginning, middle, and end, Yuki's coming of age is apparently like many other comings of age that the most important adult character, the gardener, has witnessed over the years. Combined with the obvious circle of the seasons and the repetition of dialogue to give you the repetitive nature of school days, and now I'm visualizing wheels within wheels within wheels! If that made any sense whatsoever. That said, there was another really interesting point that I wanted to bring up, and that is the fact that I don't feel like I've read all that many books about kids coming of age at 9 years old. Perhaps Tom Sawyer or Huck Finn, I certainly don't read too much in this demographic. It's been a while since I read those. But it was interesting to see that sort of story arc so divorced from any sort of burgeoning sexuality and or physical puberty. Although, yeah, I feel, the more I think about it, the more I feel like that's just a result of what I've been exposed to recently. It was also interesting to read this in such close conjunction with Deadpool Kills the Marvel Universe again, since mental health does play such a vital role in both plot lines. Unlike in Deadpool's comic, however, it was nice to be reading about someone who is perhaps more than a little delusional, or maybe not, but who is not violent or a danger to anyone, except perhaps themselves. As I mentioned in that video, I still have a few levels to go in developing my critique of how comics deal with mental health, but despite the fact that this book is supposed to be unsettling and dips in and out of mild horror, it didn't really strike me as punching down or exotifying or anything like that. Of course, agree, disagree. As I said, I'm trying to learn more about this sort of area and would love feedback from people on how they feel about the representation of mental health in comic books and movies and books. This is very general. It's just that a lot of horror does center around people being dangerously unhinged. So yeah, kind of problem. I know there's a couple of other Matsumoto fan people out there, so feel free to squee at me. I will squee with you. I'm just a bit sad that I have apparently perhaps exhausted the English translations. Really interested in what ping pong is about. But anyway, I will see you all next time. Bye!
And as always, Literally Graphic is recorded on the traditional territory of the Mississaugas of the Credit First Nation, and the Anishinaabe people, the Haudenosaunee Confederacy, and the Huron-Wendat Nation. I live here because of British colonization, Indigenous genocide, and more geographically specific, Treaty 13, also known as the Toronto Purchase, which was finalized in 1805 between representatives of the Crown and certain Mississauga peoples. This treaty was a lie and has since been broken many times over. Saying so reflects only my own small steps towards knowing the truth and does nothing for reconciliation.